Thank you very much. Welcome to everyone. Great morning so far, I think. Coach Braswell said that he didn't want to have to get up after Michael. Well, I'm not sure I want to be up after either of them. I'm just saying. Very, very powerful. There are several things that I want to accomplish today. I want to talk about some serious stuff, and I want to talk to some how-to stuff. A little different. Lots of times I spend time talking about your role as a leader, as a father when I do these, and I'm going to do a little bit of that today. But then I've got some specifics, some things that I want you to do with your children, and along the way, I hope that you'll have some tools to be better fathers, to be better parents. So let's get started. So why do we do this thing, fatherhood, parenting? Why do we do it? We do it because it's our job. Conway Twitty has a song that's called "It's My Job." We do this because it's our job. Each of us who are fathers, each of us who are parents, asked to be there. It's like some people that I work with complain about their job. And I think to myself, wait a minute. You asked for this job. You asked for this job as a parent. You asked for it. It's your job. So what about in the household where he's hers, not mine? Sorry. You're there, you're dad. You may not be father, but you're there, you're dad. Brad Paisley has a song that's called "The Dad He Didn't Have to Be," and what a special relationship that Brad Paisley had with that man growing up, where he was his dad, even though he didn't have to be. I've got one in my house that I didn't have to be. I adopted him. Raised two. My wife has raised two, and now we've got another one. Ran into a teacher from Roland Grice that I've spent some time doing traffic with years ago. I said, "Yeah, I'm back. I'm back at Roland Grice again." Sixth grader, off we go. So hers, not mine, dad's, in the house, he's yours. Make him yours. Treat him like he's yours. And then George Strait has a song called "Love Without End," and I'll read this to you because this is the real reason. This is what it's about being a dad, about being a parent. And he said, "Let me tell you a secret about a father's love, a secret that my daddy said was just between us." He said, "Daddies don't just love their children every now and then, amen. It's a love without end, amen." That's why we do this thing that's called fatherhood. That's why we do this thing called parenting, because it's a love without end, amen. So, some of the serious stuff first. I'm going to do the serious stuff, and then we're going to talk about the how-to. So, there's an author named Jim Collins that I like, and he wrote a book. There are two of his books I'm going to talk about. The first one is Good to Great. So, if you're a dad, if you're a parent, are you a good dad? Are you a good mom? Well, okay, why not great? Why not great? Good isn't enough. We all have to-do lists, and Scott Braswell and I talked about this a few minutes ago. We all have some to-do lists, but Jim Collins talked about, well, maybe we've got some not-to-do lists that we need to pay attention because our kids are watching us. Our kids are watching us, so how about we think about the not-to-do list? Remember, Michael was talking about, you know, going out behind the shed and not coming back in with the red eyes and ashy mouth, remember? All right, the not-to-do list. Those are important, and it's serious. And he says that good is the enemy of great. Good is average. You know, there are times to be excited about that B, but let's work on that A. Let's work on that A. Let's take good to great. He also wrote a book called Built to Last. So think about just the title of that book in the context of parenting and what we want for our children. Are we building them to last? Because we need to build our children to last. We need to build our children so that when they're parents, they can last, and so that they can impart the same principles of parenthood that we're trying to impart to them. We're building them to last. He talks about being like clock building, not time telling. When you build a clock and you build it well, it keeps telling time forever, doesn't it? Well, that's what we're doing with our children. So instead of saying, you know, okay, here's what time it is, we're building a clock. We're building a clock that will keep on telling time throughout their lives. That's what we're doing as parents. We are clock building. Build a vision. Build a vision, not with what you say, but with what you do, because your kids are watching. Your kids are watching you. So build a vision. You've got a vision for what your kids what you want to see your kids be when they grow up, don't you? Don't you have a vision for how you'd like for them to live? You want them to have a better life than you, don't you? You want them to be more successful, to be smarter. My kids are definitely smarter than I am. So I won there. But you build a vision with what you do, not with what you say, because your kids are watching. And eliminate the tyranny of the or in your life. We can do this or this. We can do this or this. Let's work on the and. Yes. Yes, we can accomplish this and this and this and this. Eliminate the or and include the and. So whether you're a Duke fan or not, and if you're a Duke fan, I'm sorry. For those watching this later, they won't understand the significance of the fact that Duke lost yesterday in the ACC tournament. I'm truly sorry. But Coach Mike Krzyzewski wrote a book called Leading with Heart. And there's some things that he included in that book that I think are important for us as parents, because our kids are watching us. Our kids are watching us. And these are important things. Establish discipline. Discipline is about how you interact with your child, how you correct things, about what you do. And guess how your kids will discipline when they grow up? They will discipline the way you discipline. So establish discipline. It's something that you do. Be a dynamic leader as a parent. Be dynamic. Set the example. Your kids are watching you. Be dynamic. Don't be Casper Milquetoast laying up in the recliner. Be dynamic. Be a dynamic leader in their life. Handle the crises. If you don't handle the crises, your children will see that you don't handle the crises. They will see it. They will see you run away from that trouble instead of standing up like a man or like a strong mother and taking care of it, taking care of business. Your kids will see that. Handle the crises. Focus. Focus. Be focused on your role. Your children will know if you're distracted. They'll know if you're not paying attention. Focus on your role as a parent and on your responsibility as a parent. Character's at the core. Character is at the core of being a good parent. It's at the core. So be mindful of that. Your kids are watching. Your kids are watching. Life happens, and we've all seen it. It's happened to us in our lives one time or another. Life happens. Deal with it. Don't run away from it. Deal with it. As a crisis comes, whether it's an illness or a job issue or whatever it is, that is part of life as we roll through it. Deal with it, and deal with it strongly. Your kids are watching. You will set a powerful example for them. You will set a powerful example for them. And remember, all of this comes from actions, things you do, not things you say. Your kids are watching you. Your kids are watching. John Maxwell, in the book 21 Irrefutable Laws of Leadership, had a few things that I want to share with you, because they're about our kids watching us. There's not going to be 21 of them. Don't panic. The law of, and he refers to these things as laws, the 21 irrefutable laws of leadership. Well, these are things about parenting as well. The law of solid ground: make your house safe. Make your house safe and secure. And I don't mean locks on the door. You know what I mean. Make it a safe and secure environment. Make it a safe haven for your children. The law of solid ground. The law of respect. Michael talked about that, didn't he? You look for, if you're a young woman looking for a man, how does he treat his mama? If he respects his mama, keep him. If he doesn't, what'd you say, throw him back? Throw him back. Respect. Your children are watching how you treat people, how you treat your spouse, how you treat other people. Your kids are watching. They are learning from you. And respect is so powerful. Respect is so powerful. And when they see, when your kids see you offering respect, they learn how to offer respect. They do. The law of connection. You've got to connect with your children. You have to spend time, and I'll talk about that a little bit more later. But you've got to be connected with them. And Michael was talking about, even if you're not there in the house, you still got to connect with them. You still got to connect. Even if you don't live with them, you've got to connect. The law of connection is important, because if you don't connect now, when they're younger, you never will. I tell parents who come to me in custody cases who are fighting and who are clawing and scratching for my time. I say, the day is going to come where they're going to be tired of it, where they're going to be tired of that fight, and they're going to be 18 or 20 or 21 or 22, and guess what? They're going to leave you out. They're going to leave you out when they get married. They're going to leave you out when they have a baby. They're going to leave you out at Christmas time and holiday time when you want them to come over and have turkey with you. No, they're going to say, no, I'm staying at my house. Tired of it. Tired of the drama. Connect now. Connect now, the law of connection. The law of empowerment. You have to empower your children to succeed. You enable them to be successful. And you do this in things you do, not so much things you say. Parenthood is so tough because, you know, you teach them to walk and then you want to say, stop running. You teach them to fly and then you say, come home. But those things we have to do. We have to teach them to walk so they can run. We have to teach them to fly so that they can be successful when they leave. We have to teach them, we have to empower them. And we do that through the example that we set. The law of priority. Who's number one? They are. Not me. They are. Priority in all that we do. The law of sacrifice. It's not about you. It's about them. I talk about that with parents once again. I hear them talk, well, I want my time. It's not fair. I don't have my time. It's the kid's time. It's about your child. I have parents who steal wonderful opportunities from their children because they're not willing to be flexible, because they're not willing to make it about the child and not about them. No, I'm not giving up my Saturday. No, that's my day. No, he's not going to go play in that soccer tournament because it's my day. What's up with that? Seriously. I disconnect on that, but I see it. I see it day after day after day. Priority, sacrifice. It's not about you. Remember, we asked to be here. We asked to be here. We asked for the opportunity of raising up some young people. We asked for that opportunity. So let's make it about them. Let's make it about them. Let's do what we need to do, the law of sacrifice. And the law of legacy. We leave a powerful legacy as parents. And I spent one whole Fatherhood Conference talking about leaving a legacy. I'm not going to spend the whole conference this time talking about legacy. But how we act as parents when our children are watching us leaves a powerful legacy, because that's the kind of parent they're going to be. We have the opportunity to shape wonderful parents for tomorrow. We have that opportunity right now, today, in our homes. Are we doing it or not? We're going to leave a legacy one way or the other, parents. We're going to leave a legacy that's a powerful one or a negative one. But we're going to do it. We're going to do it. And it requires working each day, day after day, with our children. And then we can leave that legacy. That's the law of legacy. And remember, all this is about actions, not words. Because why? Because our children are watching us. Our children are watching us. So another book of John Maxwell was called Attitude 101, and I specifically asked Scott Braswell about attitude because the attitude of a parent powerfully impacts that child, positively or negatively. And we've all seen that in our lives. I mean, attitude impacts everyone around you. You got anybody in your workplace who has a terrible attitude? Don't answer that. Don't answer that. But think about that. What impact does a person with a terrible attitude have on everyone around them? So imagine the impact that our bad attitude has on our children. I remember Coach said he can pick them out in the stands. He can pick them out. And he can. So can you, by the way. All you got to do is listen. You can listen for that bad attitude. You can listen for the kid. You can listen and pick out which kid is afraid to go home after the game, like Coach Braswell was talking about. You can pick that out. And can attitude be changed? Yes, but you have to change it by setting an example. We have to set that example in order to change that. And so what's failure or success for us? Success, that we're raising up young people with a positive attitude who believe they can do whatever they set a mind to do. because we have impacted them with our positive attitude, by empowering them to enable them to be successful, to make them want to be successful. It's about attitude, and once again, it's about actions, not words. Actions. Attitude isn't what you say. Attitude is how you say it. There are times that I have to say some pretty hard things to people at work. But if I try to say it in a positive way and in a way that this can get better, we've got to work through this, these are some things that we've got to do. If I have a good attitude about it, that's one thing. If I'm in there hollering at them, they're glazing over. And they're not going to be successful. So attitude. Actions, not words. I told this story last year. I'm going to tell it again because it's a powerful story, and it's about how people rub off on each one of us. And it's a story about a fellow named Charlie Plum. And for those of you who were here last year, I hope you'll remember it. If you haven't heard it before, then it's going to impact you. Charlie Plum was a fighter pilot in the Vietnam War. Flew a fighter jet, the hottest thing at the time. Flew off the aircraft carrier USS Kitty Hawk. Flew lots of successful missions, and it was almost time for him to come back home, and he was flying a mission over North Vietnam, and he was shot down and captured and spent a long time in a cell that's smaller than the size of this tabletop with nothing but a rag, alone, solitary. And he came home, and while he was there, he realized that there were lots of things that impacted him, and he came back and he went on a speaking tour because he wanted to share his story. And it was an important story to tell about, you know, how he had been captured and how he survived. And he was in a restaurant one evening, and a young man or a man came up to him and said, "So you're Charlie Plum, right?" He said, "Well, why yes." He says, "Well, you flew a fighter jet off of the USS Kitty Hawk, and you were shot down over North Vietnam and captured and spent a long time in captivity. And now you're out on the speaking tour, right?" And he says, "Yes." He says, "Well, I'm sorry, I don't think I know you. How do I know you?" And the man looked right at him and said, I packed your parachute. And that moment, Charlie Plum realized that there were lots of people that had packed his parachute through his life because of things that they did, people that he had watched, people that had impacted his life. Lots of people had helped pack his parachute that helped him survive, not just parachuting out of that burning fighter jet, but that interminable time in that cell in solitary confinement. Lots of people packed his parachute by what they did. He was watching. His parents, number one. They packed his parachute well. He had watched them. He had learned from them. Remember, we're packing our children's parachute each and every day. So I want to read a song or part of a song to you because when we picked the theme for the conference, I really wanted it to be, "I've been watching you, Dad." There's a great song, and this is where I've got to put on my I can read glasses and ditch the I can recognize you glasses. Sorry, that's one of those things. But it's a wonderful song. The first time I heard it on the radio, I went, "Wow." And every time I hear it still, I don't pull off the road, but I mean, it just impacts me. And don't panic, I'm not going to sing. I'm not saying that I haven't sung it in my truck, you know, understand, but that's by myself, because my son won't even let me sing in the truck when he's in the truck with me. Driving through town, just my boy and me, with a happy meal in his booster seat, knowing that he couldn't have the toy till his nuggets were gone. A green traffic light turned straight to red. I hit my brakes and mumbled under my breath. His fries went a-flying and his orange drink covered his lap. Well, then my four-year-old said a four-letter word that started with S, and I was concerned. So I said, "Son, now where'd you learn to talk like that?" He said, "I've been watching you, Dad. Ain't that cool? I'm your buckaroo. I want to be like you and eat all my food and grow as tall as you are. We got cowboy boots and camo pants. Yeah, we're just alike. Hey, ain't we, Dad? I want to do everything you do, so I've been watching you. I've been watching you." We got back home and I went to the barn. I bowed my head and I prayed real hard. Said, "Lord, please help me help my stupid self." Just this side of bedtime later that night, turning on my son's Scooby-Doo nightlight, he crawled out of bed and he got down on his knees. He closed his little eyes and folded his little hands, spoke to God like he was talking to a friend. And I said, "Now, son, where'd you learn to pray like that?" He said, "I've been watching you, Dad. Ain't that cool? I'm your buckaroo. I want to be like you and eat all my food and grow as tall as you are. We like fixing things and holding mama's hand. Yeah, we're just alike. Hey, ain't we, Dad? I want to do everything you do, so I've been watching you. So with tears in my eyes, I wrapped him in a hug, said, my little bear is growing up. And he said, but when I'm big, I'll still know what to do because I've been watching you. Daddy, I've been watching you. Daddy, I've been watching you. Oh, Neesmith, I recognize you again. Powerful song. Our kids are watching us. Parents, our kids are watching us. So now to the how-to stuff. And I'm you know, Michael said he talked fast. Well, I'm not from the country, but I talk fast. So I want to give you some how-to stuff today. We're going to start with five life lessons. Be around. Be there. Be around. Be a father, not a friend. Be a father, not a friend, because if you're a friend, then they're going to be scratching their head when you go to discipline them, aren't they? Right? So be a father. Show their mother respect at all times, no matter what. Sadly, we have to have parenting guidelines that we include in custody orders. And having parents treat each other with mutual respect is one of the top priorities of those parenting guidelines. Show their mother respect. Mothers, show the father respect. Y'all may not be getting along. You may not be living together. But show each other respect in front of your children. Be home for dinner. If you're living together, be home for dinner. Be home. Don't escape at work. Be home. Come home. Be home for dinner. And be their hero. Michael talked about his dad being a superhero, didn't he? Be their hero. You can be, you know. You can be. So be their hero. Remember, these things, these five things, aren't about what you say. They're about what you do. Because your kids are watching you. Your kids are watching you. So, I'm going to deal with younger children, and then I'm going to deal with some kids around sports, and then I'm going to deal with some older children with some of the how-to things that I've got for you today. Younger children, read to them nightly. They'll love it. And they'll love you. That is special time. Read to them nightly. Read to them nightly. Ask them what they did today. And then listen. Listen is one of those doing things, not talking things. I love getting up in front of groups and talking, and I know you can probably tell that I love doing this, but at work I listen. I'll have some friends say, you must get tired of talking all the time at work. I say, I don't talk at work, I listen. I listen. As parents, we've got to listen. Several years ago, I told a story about my son. He was younger then, he was probably 7 or 8. Saturday morning, bad week for me, reading the paper, second or third cup of coffee, and I'm wrapped up in me and my week. And he comes in and says, Daddy, can we play the Wii? And I said, yeah, Paul, just a few minutes. And I'm not hearing him. And he comes back in a little while and says, Daddy, can we play the Wii? I said, yeah, Paul, just a few minutes. I'm not hearing him. And he can tell. He can tell because he comes back in a little while and he puts a note down on the ottoman and walks out. I picked it up. It said, Daddy, will you play the Wii with me? Oh, holy cow. Okay, I'm listening now. I'm hearing you now. I said, Paul, come on, let's play the Wii. It's crushed. You can tell it still bothers me that I didn't listen. I didn't listen. So ask them what they did and then listen. And you know you can tell when somebody's not listening to you. You know you can tell that. Put your darn smartphone down and listen. You know, someday there's going to have to be a surgeon with a specialty of being able to detach a smartphone from someone's hand. You know, some people cannot put them down to save their lives. They can't. Kids, too. I mean, you know, but as parents, you got to put it down. Put it away. Listen. Find out about their day. Let them hang out with you. Kids like hanging out with their parents. Kids like hanging out with you. They like hanging out. Don't be too busy. Let them hang out. You know, even if it's following you around the yard when you're raking leaves or pine straw. God, I hate pine straw. Oh, I hate pine straw. But let them follow you around the yard. Ask them to help you pick up pine cones. Let them hang out with you. If you're a craftsman, you make things, let them hang out with you. Let them hang out with you. They will love it, and you will be closer because then they're watching you. They're watching you. They're learning from you because you're giving them the chance to watch. You're giving them the chance to be involved. Show them how to clean their room. That does not happen by osmosis. I know that some parents think that it does. It does not. Show them how to clean their room and clean yours. I hear some female laughter here. All right, but dads, you can clean a room too. Your legs aren't broke. Your legs are not broke. So let them know you're human. Let them know that you can make mistakes. Let them know that you can be wrong. You can still be their superhero, but you've got to be human before you can be a superhero. See, that's one of the reasons Batman's my favorite, because, you know, Batman, you know, isn't from a planet, you know, millions of miles away and came here in a spaceship and landed and, you know, grew up to be Superman. You know, Batman is an ordinary man, but he's a superhero. He's human. So in order to be their superhero, you've got to be human first. You've got to be human first. Give them responsibility, and then they will learn responsibility. Again, that's not telling them they have to be responsible. That's not telling them, that's doing. That's giving them responsibility. Whether it's responsibility to clean their room once you have shown them, or whether it's mowing the yard, or whether it's picking up pine cones, or whether it's raking that dreaded pine straw, teach them responsibility. And then they will learn from that, and they will be responsible. And yes, will there be some blips along the way if they have a responsibility and you're not supposed to have to remind them and it doesn't happen? That's okay. Failure is a part of learning. Failure is a part of learning. And that's okay. But then give it to them again and explain it again and said, okay, we can do this. We can do this, and now you're going to do this. So give them responsibility. Scream and you will raise a screamer. Okay, don't know any other way to say it. Scream and you'll raise a screamer. That's how that's going to be. So keep that in mind. So, you know, Scott Brazel talked about you know, there are times that he had to bite his tongue. Well, I got stitches across mine. Teach them not to hurt others. This may be one of the most powerful things you can do. And this teach is a show. You show them how not to hurt others because you don't hurt others. You make that choice. You don't hurt people. You don't hurt people. And you're teaching them not to hurt people. Show them that your word is your bond. Show them that. That's not telling them, that's showing them. Show them that your word is your bond. Their favorite game will be playing whatever game it is with you. You know, Michael talked about Uno. Their favorite game for a long time will be whatever game you're willing to play with them. It doesn't, and it won't matter to them what game it is. It'll be because you're playing that game. So be available. Be available. You know, I taught one of the first things was be around. Not just around, but be available. There's a difference, isn't there? Being around and being available. Because you can be around but be too busy. Be around and be available. I finally did play that Wii that Saturday morning. I finally made myself available. I was around, but I wasn't available. So be available. And by the way, even when you're tired, because as parents, we're going to be tired. You know, somebody asked me one time, you know, having a younger son, he's 11 now, having your younger son must really keep you young. I said, no, it keeps me tired. It keeps me tired. I'm older now. Holy cow. Keeps me tired, but guess what? No excuse. Being tired, no excuse. It's not. Spend time with their friends now, and they won't think twice about it later. And Lord knows when they're teenagers, you want to know their friends and be able to be around their friends. Lord knows. If you don't spend time with their friends now, you won't know their friends later. So spend time with their friends now when they're younger. The values you teach now will be the values they have as teenagers when you're dealing with younger children. And you teach values by showing them, don't you? Because they're watching you. They're watching you. It's not about what you say, it's about what you do. Check their homework. More giggles coming. It's not up to mom. Yes, mom can check homework too, but why not dad? Why not dad pitching in and checking homework too? Because you know what? Then that teaches them how important you think that is. It teaches them how important you think that is. And it's not because you say it's important, it's because you sit down and go over it and help and problem solve. And can I tell you that's hard sometimes? I'm not a mathematician. And I had to practice for like hours to be able to say that word, mathematician. That's how bad I am, okay? And so when I help with math homework, I have to have the book out and I have to work through it. But I do. I'm having to relearn algebra. Oh, gosh. I'm going to have a tutor later. I'm going to have to get a tutor to help me so that I can help him. But that's what we're going to do. That's what we're going to do. So if you bully them, if you bully your kids, and I've seen dads bully their kids, then you will absolutely raise a bully. And by the way, I'm going to digress a minute because bullying is something that's near and dear to my heart. Watch out for signs in your children of being bullied. Watch for changes in behavior. Watch for other things that are happening in their lives because bullying is so powerful. It is serious. It's not about picking on kids. It's about kids being targeted. We had a school safety summit last week where I spoke about bullying. And we're going to have a threat assessment task force that I'm going to head up that's going to look at the threats to our children in schools. And it's not just about somebody with a gun walking into a school. It's about other children bullying children. Because what happens when kids get bullied is that the kids who get bullied and the bully are more likely to be violent later as adults. Both of them are. And so we're going to find a way to put an end to that. We have to. But watch for it in your children. Pay attention to those things. Don't criticize mistakes. Scott Braswell talked about the kid that was afraid to go home after a game because of the mistakes he had made. Criticize lack of effort, but don't criticize mistakes. Help them learn from mistakes. Criticize lack of effort, lack of trying, but don't criticize mistakes. Work on the mistakes. Teach them to try new things. Remember I talked about teaching them to fly? Teach them to try new things. Not to be afraid of trying new things. And how do you teach them to try new things? Because you're willing to try new things. How do you think kids learn to eat food that's yucky? Because you're willing to do it and smile, even though you don't like it. But if you sit around the table and say, I don't like that, and me either. And they're watching you and they're learning. Be willing to try new things. And that's obviously a whole lot bigger than food. But teach them to be willing to try new things, to take adventures, to spread their wings and fly. And these things are all about action, not about words. Because I've been watching you, Dad. I've been watching you, Mom. I've been watching you. And I'm learning from you. Children in sports, don't miss their games. Don't miss their games. And, you know, Scott, you could tell that it hurt Scott that he had to miss his son's middle school football games because he was coaching. I mean, you could tell it. You could hear it in his voice. It still bothers him. He couldn't go. Pastor Barnett, who's here today, one of our partnership members, is switched his session time because somebody's got a game today at noon, and he's not going to miss it. He's not going to miss it. It got scheduled last minute. You know, when we picked this date, he had no idea, but he's going to be there. Because what's going to happen, especially when they're younger, did you see me? Oh, yes. So this morning I had some young people come running up to me. Do you know who I am? Yes, I do. Yes, I do. It's the same kind of thing. Did you see me? Take them fishing. What did Michael say? Take them fishing. Trace Atkins has a song that says, she thinks we're just fishing. There's a lot more going on than fishing. There's a lot more going on than fishing, so take them fishing. And listen and talk and laugh and celebrate and catch those fish or not catch fish. You know, if you caught fish all the time, it'd be called catching and not fishing, right? But take them fishing because they'll think that it's fishing, but it's not. It's about building relationships. So, you know, I'm going to follow in Scott's footsteps and, you know, take from Michael, and, you know, that's okay. Take them fishing. And it doesn't have to be just fishing. Take them to the basketball game. Take them to the park. Take them to the beach. Take them wherever. Take them, but take them and spend that time. And sure, take them fishing. Practice with them and they'll get better at everything, even math. Okay? But practice with them. Practice with them. They learn from you. If you find themselves yelling at them or the referee, if you find yourself yelling at them or the referee, take a book to the game and sit way the heck down at the other end by yourself. By yourself. Will you look stupid? Yes, but your kid will love you for it. Don't go there. You know, Scott identified that parent. You know, and he says you can look around the gym and up in the stands and you can pick out that parent that ought to be sitting way the heck down there with a book by themselves. What do you think happens? I've watched. I played sports and I've coached sports and, you know, for Little League and stuff like that. I have watched an 11-year-old baseball player coach just like this with the words that are coming from the grandstands behind him. Not even directed at him, but at the referee or at the umpire or whatever. And they go, "Oh, Dad, be quiet. Dad, be quiet. Please, Dad, please." Oh, and one other comment before I move on. If their sport is more important to you than to them, there's a problem, and it's not them, it's you. And you need to do something about that. You need to do something about that. Teach them how to lose. Teach them how to lose because, you know, if you play sports, you're going to experience losing. You are. And I was blessed to be play on two pretty successful basketball teams in high school. State quarterfinals my senior year. Conference championship 2 years. But we lost games. And you have to learn. You have to learn to lose. And how do kids learn to lose? Not just from coaches. They learn from us. Teach them how to win. This may be more important than teaching them how to lose. Teach them how to win. Lose without crying. Win without crowing. Okay? Lose without crying. Win without crowing. It makes a difference. And they learn that from us. From watching us. Accept the fact that they may not be a star. That they may not be a star quarterback. That they may not be a star soccer player. They may be a fabulous tuba player. Celebrate it. This goes back to if their sport is more important to you. You know, to some extent, parents drive the train. To some extent, we've got to ride alongside the train and try to guide it and try to help celebrate and try to promote. And if the interest goes to the tuba instead of the football, then let's celebrate it. And let's make them the best earned tuba player in North Carolina. Okay? There's a young man that my son and I were, Brad and I were talking about, one of his high school friends. Really good soccer player in high school. I'm not sure that he played on the school team, but they played on a rec team together. Really good. Lots of gifts as an athlete. He just qualified to be in the Navy band. That's huge. That's huge. So whatever direction it is that where they have the interest, celebrate that and make that happen. Remember, this is about actions. This is about actions because our children are watching us and how we respond to them and how we motivate them and how we move them. Children and spirituality, for just a minute. Remember, one of your primary duties is their spiritual well-being as parents. It's one of your primary duties as parents is to make sure that their spiritual well-being is tended to. Teach them that success in the face of adversity is the greatest success of all. If you can be successful in those hard times, if you can get through those hard times, then that's real success. Anybody can do it when it's easy going. Anybody can. It takes people of character. It takes people whose spiritual well-being has been taken care of to get through those hard times. Take them to Sunday school or Hebrew school or religious school or whatever it is, even though they'll say they don't like it. But if you take them, you will end up with wonderful teenagers who still say they don't like it. But you'll end up with wonderful teenagers. So take them. Pray together as a family and then teach them to pray on their own. Just like in the song. How did that young man to talk to God like he was a friend? I've been watching you, Dad. I've been watching you, Dad. So think about that. Teach them that forgiveness is not a weakness. Teach them that forgiveness is not a weakness. And that's not about saying, son, forgiveness isn't a weakness. It's about showing that. It's about living that. It's about demonstrating that. It's about action. They're watching you, and they will learn about that from watching you. So with older kids, set some goals for your older kids, for your teens. Start small. Getting them to set an alarm clock may be huge. It may be. For some teenagers who can't seem to get up in the morning, just getting them to set an alarm clock may be a worthy goal. But start small, but set goals. Help them understand that they can learn as much from failure as they can from success. Remember, part of success and part of learning is sometimes stumbling. Sometimes stumbling. The best runners in the world start off stumbling somewhere. Start off stumbling somewhere. So teach them that they can learn from failure as much as success. Remember that they're watching how you treat your dad, how you treat your mom. They're watching you, especially teenagers. They're being very perceptive because they're getting closer to that time where some teenagers already think they're grown up, but they're watching you. They're watching you. So they're watching how you treat your parents. Teach them a respect for books. How do you teach a respect for books? You read. You read in front of them. You read with them. Remember, we started when they were younger, reading to them every night? As an adult, read. Read. Teach them a respect for books. Hug every night, even at 18. And I put 29 because I wrapped my 29-year-old up in his restaurant Thursday afternoon. I did. Wrapped him right up. And I'm not going to apologize to anybody for it. And he wrapped me right up, and he's not going to apologize either. I hug him every chance I get. My daughter's not so much on hugs. I had lunch with her yesterday, and it just lit up my world. She's in Raleigh in law school, and we went to a little Mexican place that she likes and sat there for, it was awesome. And she could see, I'm beaming now, just thinking about it. So it's just awesome. So share with them how awesome you think they are. Hug them, beam, radiate when you see them. They'll know that's real. They'll know it. And yes, what did Michael say? Tell them what? Tell them I love you. Tell them you love them. Teach them to channel anger. We all get angry, one time or another. Not sure I've ever met anybody who doesn't get angry. But teach them how to channel that. And how are they going to learn how to channel that? Because they're going to watch you, right? They're going to watch you in situations where you learn how to channel anger. And remember the stitches I told you I got across my tongue. You may have them too. Learn to channel anger. Teach them that the only way to conquer fear is to walk through it. We all have fear. Courage means we can face danger despite that fear. And if we can't face danger and walk through it, what's going to happen with our kids? They won't be able to because they're not going to learn how. They're going to learn how because we can do it, because we can walk through danger even though we're afraid. We're teaching them about what we do because they're watching us. Remind them often that they can change the world. And one of the ways that you remind them is because you set out to change the world. And it may be change the world one life at a time, but you're willing to set out and change the world because you've got that incredible power. We talked about it several years ago, the power of one. You've got that ability, so show them and remind them that they can. Remind them that they can start now as teenagers changing the world by how they act, by their interpersonal relationships, They can affect change. They have incredible power. Share with them the incredible power that they have. Teach tolerance. Teach tolerance. Kids learn tolerance and kids learn intolerance from their parents. And they learn it by watching you. They learn it by watching you and how you treat people. Teach tolerance. Be kind. You teach them how to be kind by being kind. Isn't that right? Remember, they're watching you. They're watching us. Be kind. Teach them to be kind. Don't criticize them in front of their friends. Now remember, we talked about not criticizing their mistakes anyway, looking at lack of effort, but not their mistakes. But don't criticize them about anything in front of their friends. Don't call them out in front of their friends. Call to them in front of their friends. So glad to see you, and I'm glad to see all you guys too. Call to them, but don't call them out in front of their friends. Teach them to be on time. Teach them to be on time. And the first lesson is, you're on time. That's the first lesson. So you know, and being on time isn't some mysterious thing that is hard to figure out, okay? It's like, you know, I'm at school at 7:45 in the morning, every morning, to do traffic. Well, if I can be there, why can't you? Why is it that at 8:25 in the morning, after the second bell rings, that I'm still out there watching cars pour into the parking lot? I'm talking after the second bell rings. Shoot, they couldn't have left home before the first bell rang. What's up with that? What's the lesson that parent is teaching that child? It's okay to be late. So I've watched that now from the time that, this is my 19th year, I think, of doing school every day. And so I watched some kids that were classmates of my daughter's, because I started the everyday thing when she was in the second grade at Winter Park. And so I watched some of the kids, parents brought them late to Winter Park. Parents brought them late to Roland Grice. Guess what? When they had a car, guess what? They were late. They were real late. Because it was okay, because their parents taught them to be late. Teach them to be on time. And by the way, for teenagers, teach them to call. Things happen. No, I know you didn't run out of gas. I know you didn't. But teach them to call. You know, calling if you're going to be late is a matter of what? Respect. Okay? It's like when I'm on the road, I call. Call when I get there. Call when I'm on the way back. Call when I'm back. Teach them to call. They'll learn by watching you. Teach them. Teach them. Teach them to wear a seatbelt. That starts younger, but teenagers are sometimes rebellious and don't want to wear it. Well, I'm wearing mine. I'm wearing mine. And you teach them by wearing yours, by setting the example. And that may seem silly, but teach them. Can't tell you how many adults that I run into who say, you know, what's up with North Carolina having a law that I've got to wear a seatbelt? Come on, dummy. Seriously? You want to go through that windshield? Really? Because in Wilmington, North Carolina, we got the craziest drivers in the world. So I'm already talking to my 11-year-old about, okay, now, he says, is it hard driving? I said, it's not hard operating the vehicle. It's hard to watch out for those crazy people out there. The ones who want to run you off the road and run red lights and run stop signs and come flying 50, 11 miles an hour past you and then cut right back in front of you and jam on the brakes and turn. Does that make you crazy? Makes me cranky. Makes me cranky. So teach them to wear a seatbelt. Teach them what's important in life. And make sure that they understand it's not a car or a thing. And they learn that by watching what you value is important. That's how they learn that. It's because they see what you value, what you think is important. Teach them to give things away, to be generous. How do they learn that? By watching you. As citizens, as partners in this community, in this great community of ours, no matter how crazy the drivers are, we still have a great community. If we're not generous, if we don't give of our time and our earnings and our belongings, then we're not being good citizens. We're not being good stewards of what we have. and we teach them about giving by giving and by involving them in it. I remember that when my two older ones were younger, my 29 and 26-year-old were younger, Pledge Sunday at church, our family would go down and put our pledge card on the table, whatever it was. It had a different name. But it was a family thing, and all the families in the church did that. And it's about teaching them giving. It's about teaching them giving. Teach them that men do clean up the kitchen and the house every day. Okay, ladies, go ahead. They do. They need to. Remember what I said? Your legs ain't broke. Get up out of that recliner and teach them by doing. Sweep that floor. Do the dishes. Clean up your room too. You know, help with laundry. But don't wash mama's stuff. Okay? Don't wash mama's stuff, because mama's stuff's got to be done just right. But your stuff, kids' stuff, do it. Help with the laundry. Anybody can do towels, okay, guys? I'm serious. I'm just saying. So teach them that men do those things. The words, "that's a woman's job," should not be in their vocabulary. Fathers to sons should not be in their vocabulary, because we all pitch in. We're family. We do it together. We help. Got to learn it. They learn it from you. They learn it from you. Encourage community service, giving back to the community. How do they learn that? By watching you. By watching you. My son and I talk about that. He said last night, he said, "What are you doing tomorrow morning, Dad? Don't you have something?" And I said, "Yeah, we've got our Fatherhood Conference." And he said, "Why do you do that?" I said, "Because it's important. It's important for me to do. I've got the ability to get up in front of a room of people and talk. I have a gift of gab. I love to teach. I love to see people come back year after year because they're excited about learning. It's something that I can do to give back. And so even though it's Saturday morning, and yeah, that second or third cup of coffee at home would have been great in the Saturday paper or whatever, I'll get a paper on the way home. I'll stop at Harris Teeter and get one. It'll all be good. But I talked to him about what I do and why. About why I ran the road yesterday, leaving home at 6 to do a WebEx at the Administrative Office of the Courts, and then in a committee meeting, a statewide committee meeting that I chair. I talked to him about why I do those things. You do community service and you talk to your children. Take them with you. Take them with you to do it. When they have a cleanup day at the elementary school or at the middle school or the high school, go with them. Go with them. Set the example. Teach them to look in the eye and how to shake hands. It's important. When a young person will look me in the eye and reach out and shake my hand, I know something about their parents. I know something about their parents. And sometimes I know something about their foster parents, because I had that experience this morning. I know they didn't get it from their parents, because I know their parents. I don't know their foster parents, but I know something about them. And they've taught them well. They've taught them well. Right here and right here. "Judge Corpening, do you remember me?" "Yes, I do. Yes, I do. And I'm so glad to see you here today." Teach patience, kindness, and tolerance. And if you don't teach these three things, you will wish you had. Because one of the things that that Michael and I think Coach Braswell talked about too, this span of time from birth to 18 is a short time span over the life of your children and your relationship with your children. It is a short time span. And the most important things happen later. The things you'll want to celebrate and be a part of. And if you haven't taught these three lessons to your children, you will watch them and you will rue the day that you forgot to do that. Because you will watch a child that's grown up to be something that you didn't intend. Expect excellence from your children. It's okay to expect them to be excellent. Teach them to stand up for what's right. Even when everyone else thinks they're wrong, even you, teach them to stand up for what's right. Teach them to stand up straight. Teach them to be willing to ask for help. How do they learn that? How do they learn standing up straight, asking for help? They learn by watching you. Your kids are watching you. Teach them that the solution to most problems is not found in a pill. Teach them that. They're watching you. If it's got to be a pill for you, to get you through the day, if that's what it is, they're watching you. Teach them that the answer to most things is not found in a pill. Teach them the joy of finishing a job. They're going to learn that by watching you. By watching you. Teach them that appearances matter. They do. Teach them. And how do they learn that? They're watching you. Teach them to be kind. They learn that by watching you. Believe in them. That's a doing thing. Believe in them. Absolutely believe in them. Every day, all day, believe in them. Actions. Actions, actions, because our kids are watching us. Our kids are watching us. Teach equals show. Anytime I've used the word teach today, it's about showing. It's about doing because our kids are watching us. Remember the song. Don't ever let those words get out of your head. I've been watching you, Dad. Where'd you learn to talk like that? I've been watching you. Where'd you learn to pray like that? I've been watching you, Dad. Share some words from two of my favorite philosophers before I go, Batman and Yoda. Yoda's my favorite intergalactic philosopher. So Batman says, it's not who I am inside, but what I do that defines me. It's not who I am inside, but what I do that defines me. Your kids are watching you. And from Master Yoda, do or do not, there is no try. Your parents, do it. There's no try, just do it. Thanks so much for being here this morning. Angelina will have your instructions for the next session.